Thank you, Ron. That was very inspiring. So it is now my pleasure to introduce our next moderator, Dr. Jonathan Mermin, who is the director of the National Center for HIV/AIDS, Viral Hepatitis, STD, and TB Prevention under the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And he also serves as an adjunct professor at Maurice Rowland School of Public Health. He was formerly the director of the CDC in both Kenya and Uganda. Dr. Mermin has been involved in implementing programs and research of infectious diseases, including HIV, malaria, TB, and other emerging infections. And he will lead the opening plenary panel session. Welcome.
Well, thank you, Veronica, and good evening. I really appreciate your organizing this meeting, in particular because it joins together science, program, policy, and community for HIV and hepatitis. And for those of us who work in the middle of that Venn diagram of these infections, it's a rare and exciting event. I'm fortunate to have on this panel with me tonight three distinguished people in the fields of HIV and hepatitis, whom I will introduce shortly and ask to come up. But before I do, I just wanted to highlight some of the strategic opportunities and challenges that we have ahead of us. There are considerable difficulties for domestic HIV and hepatitis prevention and treatment that we will have over the next few years, from political, from scientific, and from resource perspectives. We have restricted budgets and resource uncertainties. And as Ron noted, we live with the frustration of having highly effective curative care for hepatitis C that is unavailable to many people due to health system structures, limitations in the medical science, lack of programmatic experience, and cost. However, we're also at an unprecedented time for public health, HIV and hepatitis, in some ways because of these difficulties. So the onset of health reform provides substantial opportunity at the same time that it creates anxiety, not just because of the upcoming Supreme Court decision. We should live in a world where walking into a health clinic, everyone who meets age-based screening recommendations is tested for HIV and hepatitis C because clinical decision tools pop up reminders in the electronic medical record. Where people at higher risk for HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C are provided proven effective education and behavioral interventions, treatment, and social or economic support to decrease their risk. Where people with HIV are routinely asked about their sexual risk, their partners provided HIV testing and consideration for PrEP, and they receive ART and proven behavioral interventions to reduce risky sexual behavior and improve adherence and retention in care. I can see a country where the social and cultural norms support HIV and hepatitis prevention and treatment, where the environment and legal situation makes most sex safer sex, where we protect the dignity and the human rights of people with HIV and hepatitis and those most affected by these infections, and where surveillance data for HIV and hepatitis B and hepatitis C are used to improve individual care by ensuring that people are contacted if they have fallen out of care and that they receive access to effective treatment, and in the case of hepatitis C, are cured. However, this will not occur if we don't seize this moment. We need to do this for the people we serve who have HIV or hepatitis or at high risk for infection, for the groups of people deeply affected by these infections, including gay and bisexual men, Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders, African Americans and Latinos, transgender men and women, and people who inject drugs, and ultimately all Americans. So, however, making a substantial difference takes time, planning, and effort, and scientific discovery along the way. CDC's initial HIV screening guidelines involved over a decade of action, ranging from developing and evaluating new diagnostic tests, writing and advocating for sometimes controversial policies on counseling, consent, and named reporting, conducting studies on the efficacy of testing with regard to behavior change, learning from experience throughout the country, and monitoring effectiveness. New hepatitis C guidelines took less time, but have similar need for expanded implementation. Yet, having accurate knowledge of one's own HIV and hepatitis status is, in many ways, a human right. With that in mind, I want to highlight seven areas that I think are critical to our continued success. The first is testing. All people with HIV and hepatitis B or C and their partners should know their infection status and be linked to care and prevention services. Getting the job done and making testing as routine and facile as possible continue to be challenging. The second is effective treatment and prevention with positives. All people with HIV, HBV, and hepatitis C and their partners deserve ART, effective therapy for HBV, or to be cured of their hepatitis C infection. And they should know how not to transmit their infection to others, and if need be, receive comprehensive behavioral, medical, and structural services. The third is the use of policy systems and environmental interventions. We should set up an enabling environment where the healthy choice is the easy choice. This includes researching potentially effective policy and structural tools and implementing existing ones in a multi-layered approach that focuses on individual, group, and community levels. This means that governmental and institutional policy should facilitate a wide range of interventions, ranging from health insurance reimbursements for testing and treatment to housing services. And we should examine the effectiveness of policy interventions on incidence and access to services, whether related to drug use or testing guidelines. The fourth is to target resources. We should focus efforts and resources where the epidemics are and among people who are most at risk for acquisition. This will mean focusing prevention efforts among people with the highest risk of acquiring HIV or viral hepatitis, epidemiologically, behaviorally, and situationally, including social determinants of infection. And ultimately, maximizing impact by assessing population burden, identifying effective interventions with the most potential impact on infections averted or quality-adjusted life years saved, and incorporating feasibility for full-scale implementation into our decision-making. The fifth is to monitor our epidemics and our programs. We should continue to effectively monitor and communicate about prevalence, incidence, and mortality, care utilization, behavioral trends, and process indicators for our programs. This means recognizing the importance of effective surveillance systems and allocating resources, and realizing that information not communicated effectively travels to a place of darkness, never to be seen again. The sixth is to continue to use science to improve what we do. Science matters. Without it, we would not be curing hepatitis C or using PrEP. We would not be diagnosing someone with early HIV infection or understanding the effect of syringe service programs. We need to continue to conduct applied, operational, economic, and implementation research to assess and improve our programs. And the seventh is to work at all times towards health equity. Many of us are drawn to work in HIV and hepatitis because of a passion for doing public health good, a knowledge that accepting health inequity is untenable, and that we must infuse all of our activities with the idea that disparities in incidence, prevalence, access to care, and prevention services turn AIDS and hepatitis from illnesses into injustice. So thank you.